Two. One, two. One, two.
Lord.
Let me say good morning to everybody. Hello, everybody. Can I get your attention, please? We want to welcome all of you who are here this morning to pay your last respect to the deceased infant. We want to start almost right about now because time perhaps for us is the more important thing at this time. So we want to just salute those on the outside to indicate to them if they are on the list, they can occupy a seat inside. And from that point onward, we would want to begin the service. So invite all of you at this time to stand, please. Vletu mundu bot suple ek nokamado poupan a 6 ans dedans so that nous a commencé à servir ta. All right, let us bow our heads. Father in heaven, thank you so much for the privilege to be in the land of the living, and that we don't want to take for granted. But we invite your presence to be with us today, as with sadness and heaviness of heart, that we would conduct this service. But the very fact that we have no control, we pray that you would monitor the would allow you to be in control and in charge. So be with us now as the service commences. We thank you in Jesus' name. Thank you very much. All right. Thank you. Be seated, please.
I want to say a special good morning to everyone. I want to thank all those who have made it their duty to be here to support the family. The Bible says in Matthew 5 verse 4, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. So don't think that you are in this alone. The Lord is there with you to comfort and to cheer you. We shall turn to our leaflet and sing the first song, When the Roll is Called Up Yonder. When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the Savior boat shall gather over on the other shore, and the rolling call up yonder, I'll be there. When the rolling call up yonder, when the rolling call up yonder, yonder, when the road yonder, I'll be there. On that bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share, when his chosen one shall gather to their home beyond the sky, and the rolling skull up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up up yonder, I'll be there. Let us labor for the master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
Amen. We will sing for the second song, Children of the Heavenly Father. Children of the Heavenly Father, safely in his bosom gathered, nestly burn us in heaven, such a refuge it was given. God is on the tend and nourish, in his holy love they flourish. From all evil things he spares them, in his mighty arms he bears them. Neither life nor death shall ever from the Lord his children sever. Unto them his grace he showeth, and their sorrows all he knoweth. Praise the Lord in joyful numbers, your protector never slumbers. At the will of your defender, every foeman must surrender. Though he God is chief, forsaken, he's the loving purpose only to preserve them pure and holy. Hallelujah. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Days are filled with sorrow and care. Hearts are lonely and dread. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near. Calvary, Calvary, burdens are lifted at Calvary, Jesus is very near. Cast your care on Jesus today, leave your worry and fear. Burdens are lifted at Jesus is very near. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Calvary, Calvary. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near. Soul, the Savior can see every heartache and tear. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Calvary, Calvary. Burdens
arms are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near.
Amen. Never part again. There is a land of pure delights.
There is a land of pure delight where bliss eternal reigns. Infinite day excludes the night, and pleasures banish pain. We're traveling to Emmanuel's land, where soon shall hear the trumpet sound, and soon we shall with Jesus reign, and never, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. Never part again. No, never part again. And soon we shall with Jesus reign. And never, never part again. There everlasting springs abide, and never withering flood. And but a little space divides this heavenly land from ours. We're traveling to Emmanuel's land, we soon shall hear the trumpet sound, and soon we shall with Jesus reign. Never, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. And soon we shall with Jesus reign. And never, never part again. Could we but stand where Moses stood and view the landscape home? Not all this world pretended good could ever charm us more. We're traveling to Emmanuel's land, we soon shall hear the trumpet sound, and soon we shall with Jesus reign, and never, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. Soon we shall with Jesus reign. And never, never part again.
Amen. I shall see the King.
I shall see the King. The angels sing. I shall see the King someday in a better land on the golden strand. And with him shall ever stay in his glory. I shall see the King. his praises sing. 'Twas on Calvary Jesus died for me. I shall see the King someday. In the land of song, in the glory throne, where the never comes for night. With my Lord once slain, I shall ever reign in the glory land of light. In its glory, I shall see the King, and forever endless praises sing. 'Twas on Calvary Jesus died for me. I shall see the King someday. I shall see the King all my tributes bring, and shall look upon his face. Then my song shall be, how he ransomed me and escaped me by his grace. In his glory I shall see the King, and forever endless praises sing. 'Twas on Calvary Jesus died for me. I shall see the King someday.
Amen. When he cometh,
right, we want to continue with the service, and we ask the pall bearers, if you would kindly wheel the coffin in as the congregation stands. We're going to have a question. Stand, everybody, as we do the entrance in, please.
Show this man
when you come.
When he cometh, when he cometh to make up his jewels, all his jewels, precious jewels, his love and his own, like the stars of the morning, his bright crowns adorning, they shall shine in their thanks for his kingdom. All the pure ones, all the bright ones, his love and his own. Like the stars of the morning, his bright crowns adorn him. They shall shine in their beauty, bright gems for his crown. Little children, who love their Redeemer, are the jewels, precious jewels, his love and his own. Like the stars of the morning, his bright crowns adorning, they shall shine in their beauty, bright gems for his crown.
Amen.
We want to welcome every one of you that have made it your business to be here this morning to stand in solidarity with the deceased family, the grieving family. And really, we want to welcome you. We know some hearts are touched and stricken with grief, pain if you want. But even in these moments, there's somebody who is always there to comfort, to cheer, to allow for the family, the grieving one that is, to be comforted by the fact that he always sticks closer than a brother to lighten your burden. So we welcome all of you. We are concerned about the family. It would seem that death is, we say quite often one to visit this family in particular, but we trust God is going to, as it were, have his arms around them to keep them protected, keep them strengthening. I wanted this time to continue singing as we continue with the service. We would sing from your brochure. Of course, if you have had received a brochure, you could always follow. Please.
When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the Zeva Bella shall gather over on the other shore, and the rolling call up yonder, I'll be there. When the rolling call up yonder, 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 I'll be there. On that bright and cloudless morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of his resurrection share, when his chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the rolling call up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn to setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is is over and our work on earth is done. And the roll is called, yonder I'll be there.
Oh,
when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
We will have the scripture reading at this time.
Our scripture is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 to 55. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is victory?
Amen. I invite the congregation to kneel with me as we shall have prayer. Dear God and our Father, we give thanks this morning for allowing us to be in this place. We recognize your goodness, recognize your mercies. And we just ask that you would stop by today, dear Lord, to allow for blessings, for strength. We want to give you the family that this morning is stricken with grief. Their moan, their tears, their heart is rent. And God, as we look at the state of affairs, we sometimes wonder whether these things take you by surprise. But then we are reminded, your love and mercies are always over your children. This morning, dear Lord, death has strike again. This morning, it's little Joseph Sina that is the victim. So we just want to pray, dear Lord, that you would remember the mother who gave birth to that little girl. We have just looked at this little girl hardly has come into this life. And to be departing at this time when she was just really in infancy, if we want to put it this way. But God, you saw it coming. The mother, grandmother, great-grandmother didn't have a clue as to what and when. But God, you saw it all before. And so it is this reason we invoke your presence and we ask that you would descend in this place and make manifest your saving grace and your love. Touch the mother, we pray you, the father of this little girl. Be with the grandparents, Lord. They have come to give support, but even then, Lord, the burden is heavy. We pray that you would lighten their load. Give them mercy measurelessly. Allow them to be mindful of the fact this life, they are very painful moments. But even when the pain comes, you're able to succor them that are tempted, them that are tried. So come by today, dear Lord, and have your way as this service continues. Grant that word would be spoken. It would be words of cheer, words of comfort, words that will help them to understand in this life we may experience pain and frustration. But there's coming a day when life would have ended and death would have swallowed up in victory. Death will be no more. And God, your people would reign with you ceaselessly through time and eternity. So stop by here today. See the mourners. Dry the tears, every tear from the eyes of those who are present. And grant, Heavenly Father, as we look forward to your speedy return, may we exercise faith in Jesus Christ. Today, dear Lord, the message for the mother, the message for the grandparents, that this innocent child have not done nothing in this life. And what is very important, that if the mother, the father, the parents and grandparents would have made peace with you, it's quite likely, Lord, in the next life, when the road is going to call up yonder, this little child would reappear. So we ask God today to have your way control, and we bless you in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Thank you. The program that I have with me, we have persons who are taking part in the service this morning, and we want to tell you that you know where you fit, and we would appreciate if you can turn up at the time when your name would be as it were the one to play that particular part. Let me welcome all of you again. We thank you for stopping by to pay your last respect, stand in solidarity with the family. And there's no question as to whether the family need your support at this time. I think I can recognize quite well the mother. Yes, the mother. And I think that's the father of the child sitting nearby. I think I recognize the grandmother. And there's the great-grandmother. Where's Magdalene? Where are you, Magdalene? Yes, let me just see them inside. I mean, I know I've not been, that's not the first time I'm standing before and recognizing the family, especially when they have lost a loved one. Some time ago, it was the great-grandmother who had lost one of her siblings. This morning, she's not here as the direct mother, but she's here as the great-grandmother or great-great. I think she comes in on two counts. I think the grandmother is here, the great-grand is here, and Sister Evans would be the great-great-great-grand. Am I saying it well? Very well. So we want to extend condolences on behalf of the church, its leaders, Pastor Joseph and myself, and I must tell you, we are very grateful for Pastor Joseph, his role, and his function within the organization, that is the St. Lucia Mission, plays a very important role. He's in charge of all the pastors, and he was able to take time off his busy schedule to sit with us this morning and to allow the funeral service to take effect. Pastor, we are very grateful for your presence, and thank you very much for, as it were, giving us some of your time this morning. We know you always have a busy schedule. I want to state as well that with regards to our service, generally, we don't always have services for children. Let me rephrase that. I don't always have the opportunity to stand before a congregation and preside over a child's burial. I think in my ministry for a few years now, I've had just a few occasions when a little child was to be buried. And as I said in my prayer, Mother, a lot has to do with what you do from today onward. Your child can be given back to you in the hereafter, but it means that you would have to be in the presence of God when the road would have called up yonder. And I say that to the father as well, because what is very obvious Children would reappear in eternity if the parents themselves are there. And that should say quite a lot to parents who are here. I don't want you to miss that point. Sunya timamai. Ek timamaila mo. Ek wumem pa anweyom modye. Modye pakai pouvien timamai sala pawet. But souvle wet timamai encore, nuka. Nous avons applaudi, nous avons bau conseil pour marcher avec Jésus en la vie. Cela. Et si maman et papa marchent avec Jésus, il est bien possible que ti maman et la kai vie par le corps. Immediate mother, so to speak, and father. But to every one of us who have children, if your child died at a tender age and the child is not able to reason or knows wrong from right, then the child would reappear in eternity if the parents are there. That should say quite a lot to mothers and fathers who don't pay attention to when God has allowed them to have children, that they pay attention to the children that God has allowed them to bring into this world. Let me just give way now to the other persons on the program. At least we would invite them at this time to come through.
Good morning, everyone. This is really not an occasion that I think any of us here would want to be at, but we have to understand that our only answers can come from our Heavenly Father. He's the only one who could give us the answers to such questions. The song I'm about to sing is dedicated to Ziva from her mommy. I want you to pay close attention to the words of this song. It is called "I Will Carry You." There were photographs I wanted to take, things I wanted to show you, sing sweet lullabies, wipe your teary eyes, who could love you like this? People say that I am brave, but I'm not. Truth is, I'm barely hanging on. But there's a greater story written long before me, because He loves you like this. I will carry you while your heart beats here, long beyond the empty cradle, through the coming years. I will carry you. And I will praise the one who's chosen me to carry you. Such a short time, such a long road, all this madness, but I know that the has brought me to His voice, and He says, I've shown her photographs of time beginning, walked us through the parted seas. Angel lullabies, no more teary eyes. Who could love her like this? I will carry you while your heart beats here, long beyond the empty cradle, through the coming years. I will carry you all your life. I will praise the one who's chosen me to carry you.
The person to do the story of the deceased. This
eulogy was written by her mother. Ziva Bella Joseph was 2 years, 5 months, and 4 days old. Born on the 5th of October, 2018 at 11:58 p.m. She lived her life with her mother, Benicia Mafre, and also her stepfather, Kenan Leons. In that time, she learned to be outspoken, loving, caring, funny, and energetic. She attended Leoba's daycare in Kako Babono, where she was loved and cared for. Ziva was just everyone's pride and joy the moment she entered the room. When she was born, the only person she wanted to be attached to was her mother. She loved everybody else from a distance. But then eventually, she got attached to her two favorite cousins, Phoebe and Katali Constantine, which allowed her to become even more friendly and loving. She would call babies baby as if she was a grown person. She loved the outdoors, always wanted to be on the move. She loved going to the garden with her godfather, Mr. Joe, also known as her papa, and her grandmother, also known as her nanny. She was just so full of life. Calling her a bundle of joy would be underrating her. Ziva gave her mother the love that she didn't know she was missing. She filled the family's heart with warmth. She liked giving jokes, for example. She would call her mother by her name and then laugh. She even told her mother and her stepfather that she had a boyfriend. That was just Ziva, making the best out of every moment. We're sad that you're gone, knowing that we were preparing for your bright future. You will always be in our hearts because your memories weigh more than gold and worth more than diamonds. Continue to grace us with your presence. Sleep in peace, baby Ziva. May the angels in heaven rejoice as they have received a pure soul. Thank you.
Right, me. Ask Pastor Joseph and his time to.
We ask that you would hold your seats as Pastor Joseph brings to us words of comfort, words that would soothe some of the pain that you are having now. Pastor Joseph.
Good morning, everyone. And thank you, Pastor Miller, and for your kind words of introduction. We meet to mourn passing of an infant child. And as you have heard in the eulogy, it's just 2 years plus. And I do know that this certainly brings pain to the heart of everyone. A flower that is a life, sorry, that's cut down and just the blossoming stage of life is certainly not one that will just easily slide by. For the intent of everyone who's born is to go through the processes of normal growth stages. And no parent ever plans to eulogize their child. Parents expect their eulogize her, and so I'd want to extend condolences to the family on behalf of the members of the Bethany Church and the Sarset Church, where Sister Evans worshipped and ministered, and other members of the family. And it is with that commitment that we have taken on the responsibility of conducting this service as our part of ministering to and to bring healing to the family. Just before I speak, I'd want to remind you of the protocols. And for those who may not have known, for funeral services to be conducted within this COVID period, we who manage the church has to submit to the police the names of all those who will attend the funeral services and get permission from the commission of police before the service can be conducted. And that information filters down to the police station in the community so that COVID wardens will know that a funeral service is conducted here this morning so that they can pass by to make sure that the protocols are adhered to. If they are not adhered to, then they will hold us responsible. I thought I should remind you and let you know to please adhere to the protocols. If you're from the same household, then you can sit together. Now, some people say families, not families, households. If you live in the same house, you can sit together. And then you do the distancing thereafter. I just thought I should remind you of the protocol. Let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, we are very grateful to you for life. And thank you, Lord, that we can meet to eulogize this infant child who, in the budding stages of her life, has been cut down. Lord, we come not to you with blame. We come not to you in an angry spirit. But, oh God, we come to be healed. We have come for you to minister to us, the living, the father, the mother, the grandmother, the great-grandmother, and other family members. We all meet here today, Lord, because we are pained and we are broken, looking for the light amidst the darkness, looking for hope amidst this despair, looking for some form of encouragement, looking to have burdens lifted. Oh God, we pray today that you will come by and minister to everyone, dear Lord. May your spirit take charge of us, we pray, in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. I want to begin by stating categorically clear that God never intended funeral services for the human family. When God created Adam and Eve, for parents in the Garden of Eden, it was never God's intent for funeral services to be conducted. God's intent was that man will live and live and live and live throughout eternity and never die. God's intent was that joy and happiness, Pastor Miller, and sweet fellowship will be the order of the day. And so God told Adam and Eve that, look at this garden that I've created for you. I want you to dress it and to keep it. And you would note, those who are biblical students, that in the Garden of Eden were not just flowers and vegetation, but animals were there. And all of God's creation were there. The cat and the dog, the lion and the lamb, the bear and the elephant, they all lived together in that environment God had created for them. And so God's intent, folks, this morning is that there'll be peace among human beings, peace among the animal kingdom, peace everywhere, because God himself is both love and peace. And so service and all other funeral services must never be placed at the feet of God. You know, God would have it so. No, God never intended it so. The tragedies of this world, the mishaps of this world, the pains that we feel, the agonies we experience, none of these God intended. But rather, the Genesis story tells us that an old devil came down in the form of a serpent, and he was able to beguile the first Eve, who disobeyed God's explicit command not to touch, not to eat of the fruit. And when she got it, the Bible declares that her eyes were opened. In other words, she began to see things in a different light. She began to see things differently. And so she ran to her husband and said, "You also disobeyed God so you could see like me." I want to let you know this morning that when you begin to see not the way God sees, something is happening to you. Anytime one gets to the place where it's about what he sees and what she sees and what he understands and what she understands, and it does not synchronize with what
God had laid down for us, something is wrong, if you please. And you'd agree with me today that there is nothing that brings chaos in this world like those who are brilliant, who see a lot. The philosophers who can dial down and philosophize, like those who can reason, they claim, brilliant, if you please. Look at their own wisdom because their eyes are opened, if you please. So they see better. They see better. They see stuff that other folks don't see. And if you don't agree with them, then something is wrong with you. I've come by to let us understand today that God had laid down in his word and continues to lay down in his word the principles that govern his kingdom. And those principles, praise God, this morning has never changed. What changed that man's eyes were opened and man began to see what they want to see. And want to do what they want to do. Look at what happened. Look at what happened when Eve found out that her eyes were opened. God had to come down into the Garden of Eden, and then try to bring some peace and some order amidst the chaos that existed, and said, "Hello. In this chaos that you have created, you will die. But I have a plan to rescue you. Bring some peace and some order in that chaos." May I declare to you this morning that when man disobeys God and does not adhere to the principles of God, lives are lost. I'll say that again. When man does not adhere to the principles of God, lives are lost. Right there, in the early history of humanity, as recorded in the Word of God, two brothers, Cain and Abel. And God said, bring a lamb for an offering. That was the word of the Lord. But Cain was wiser than God. His eyes were opened, and so he became wiser than God and wise in his own skin. And so instead of obeying God and doing what God has asked him to do, he brought what he wanted, what he thought was right. And so he brought an offering of fruits to the Lord. The Lord never asked him. God's explicit command was that you bring a lamb. And so the Lord accepted and blessed he who had been obedient to him, and hello, what was the result? He who received the blessings of the Lord became an enemy of him who was disobedient. And I want to submit to you today that it's no different, because the same forces, the same enemies are still alive. And all folks need to do today is just to obey the Lord. That in itself makes you enemies of those who do not obey the Lord. And so moving away from God's divine commandment causes folks to be enraged. And so the first killing of man by man occurred in early humanity, all because of the sin there And Cain took his brother's life. And the hard thing about it is, having taken his brother's life, when God came by and asked him to give an account for his brother, he couldn't give a proper account. And the Lord told him straight, "The blood of your brother crieth to me for justice." And I declare this morning that all the innocents whose lives are taken at the hands of others for whatever reason, those will be required to answer to God for innocent lives. God himself came down and says, "This is my son." You see, the thing about it, God wanted him to understand that he who did not give life should never take life. Because all life belongs to God. And God does not sit by idly, I declare this morning. God does not sit by idly when innocent lives are taken. As in this case, God could have sent an angel to Cain. God could have dispatched other heavenly agencies to Cain. But the lives of the innocent who serves the Lord is precious to God. Because they are precious to him, God came down himself. Check the Bible and see how many times God dispatched angels to attend to stuff. Angels to attend to the children. Angels to attend to that. But I declare this morning that the life of an innocent person is a life that is precious to God. And so God did not dispatch an angel, but he came himself to ask of Cain, "Give an account for the life of my son. Give an account for the life of my child." And I declare this morning that that same God is still alive. He's going to ask for the account. He's going to ask for the account. This little girl whose life was sniffed in an early age. Note very well that Adam knew and Eve knew that their son was dead. And they also knew why. Adam and Eve, the parents of Abel, knew that their son was killed, Pastor Miller. And in their rage and in their sorrow, in their grief, in their anger, they could have taken matters in their own hands. But they believe that vengeance belongs to the Lord. They believe that God somehow will come through with justice in his own time and his own way. They believe that God somehow will intervene, not in our time, but in his time. And that God will hold Cain responsible for his brother's life. They knew that. And they knew that. You see, they understood very well. They understood very well that the God we serve is a God of justice. And that one of these days, Cain would be made to answer. And so for the rest of the Bible's history, you would read time and time again of innocent lives that have been taken. But let me hasten on to say to you, that while sin manifested itself here, in a life that was taken, sin also manifests itself in other ways. all forms of injustices are just to be seen and noted as manifestations of sin. You know, sometimes we have a way of giving different emphasis on the magnitude of wrong. Let me declare to you this morning, wrong is wrong. Whether it's one that caused a lot of pain or one that caused a little pain, both are wrong. And from since then, sin has manifested itself in envy, has manifested itself in malice. Sin has manifested itself in worldliness. Sin has manifested itself in worshiping individuals, in fact, others that are not gods. Sin has manifested itself in unfaithfulness of husband to wife and wife to husband. Sin has manifested itself in all sorts of manners that brings pain to the human being. And so I want to declare to you before closing the service this morning that in whatever form sin manifests itself, God has the answer. In whatever form we feel pain and grief and are burdened, in whatever form I see that our joys are taken away, the God we serve is a God who has empathy with us all. In whatever form. And so all children who are victims of others, I declare to you this morning that you are not missed by God. You're not missed by God. And God's desire is that all the pains of this universe, all the pains in our community, all the pains of humanity that He never intended for us, that God will bring them to an end one day. He'll bring them to an end one day. And what gives us joy as preachers is to point men and women and let them know that while the days are dark now, there is a better tomorrow that's awaiting. While the days are gloomy now, there's a better day that's waiting for all of us. Yeah, while things are dark and it does not go well, that God has a plan to change stuff. That this world is not going to remain as dark and gloomy as it is with all forms of injustices and pain and burdens. But God has a plan to renew this earth again. That's the hope. That's the hope. And earlier Pastor Miller did say, and I just want to reemphasize what he has said. You know, I lost a baby sister just a year and two months old. And I know the pain. I know the pain. I was a teenage boy when I lost my baby sister. And just yesterday I was reflecting on her. I was old enough to remember her. And what gave me joy and peace is knowing that children who have not gotten to the place of making a decision for the Lord Jesus and to give their lives to Him, as long as their parents make it right with God, we are told that angels will bear those little children back in their arms and give them to the mothers who laid them to rest. And I thank God that my mother made it right with the Lord before she died. And that gave me hope that one of these days I'll see my baby sister Patricia again. That gives me hope. And the same hope is there for you folks, because God wants to save the little child. But if He saves the little child in eternity and mommy is not there, then which family would she be attached to? And so while you mourn and while you grieve today, know that God's plan is to reunite the family. That's God's plan. That's God's plan. And for the family to be reunited, folks, I need not tell you the whole story, but your Bible clearly states that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever, whatever your race, whatever your language, whatever your sex, whatever it is, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And so in Jesus, I say this morning, there's salvation available for everyone in Jesus. And those who are washed in the blood of the Lamb, washed in the blood of the Lamb, are children of God, he says. When Jesus went to Calvary's cross, he went to Calvary's cross to pay the price for man, for Adam's sin, and for our sins too. And so by coming forth from the tomb on that Sunday morning, and Jesus declared, I have the keys of death, of hell, and the grave. He was saying that what the devil took away, I have power to return. That's life. That's life. I have power to return. Not only does God have power to return, as I finish this service, not only does God have power to return life, but God has a plan to recreate this world. God has a plan to recreate this earth and make it fresh again. And so when John, who was banished on the Isle of Patmos to die, was in the spirit, and John himself banished there from humanity, banished on the Isle of Patmos alone, there the Lord showed him through the ages the history of the church and God's people and the raging battles between good and evil. And John saw them all. And at the end of it, God said, John, and let me show you how it's going to end. And in Revelation chapter 21, God showed John how it will end. Verse 1 says, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth was passed away, and there was not passed away, sorry, and there was no more sea. You know, from home, coming to the service and reflecting on this sermon, it occurred to me that when the Lord told John, I'll create a new heavens and a new earth, he was not talking about the heaven of heavens. He was talking about the atmospheric heaven. Also, where the birds fly, that God's gonna make all those new. And so in the new heaven and new earth, there'd be no more storms, because that heavens would be recreated. There would be no turbulence in the sky, no more hurricane seasons, if you please. God's gonna make all things new, create new heavens, if you please. The starry heavens will be made new. The solar system will be made new. God make all of those new. The heavens will go, and not only that, but he says, I'll create a new earth, for the first earth had passed away. Let me just declare to you here that when John saw the first earth passed away, it was oil. Hang in with me a while. When John saw the first earth passed away, it wasn't soil, whether it's clay or sand. You know what I'm talking about? Or the type of soil. That is not what he was talking about. He was talking about the earth and its contents. The earth and its contents were passed away. And so no more dry twigs. They're gone. No more falling leaves and falling branches. They're gone. they're gone. And the folks who are not godly people are not going to be there because they're gone too. They're gone too. All those who will take life and take away people's liberty and take away people's property, they're gone too, if you please. And in that new earth, because it is new and the old one has passed, there's going to be a certain quality of life, if you please, for everybody. And in that quality of life, John says that there shall be no more crying. Hallelujah, somebody. John says that God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. That's talking about a quality of life. No more emotional pains. No more pain of losing. No more pain of not having enough. No more pain. No more expression of emotional grief, if you please. The tears are gone from their eyes. And moreover, John said, the angel told John, death. No more Lazarus. No Rambalis. Cricks are out of business. No more death. And they have no more world, no more need for pastors because there are no funerals to be conducted. We're going to be relieved of all our duties. But folks, listen. I want you to lift your eyes today from the gloom that's around you. Are you listening to me this morning? Listen, I'm not saying your pain isn't real. Huh? I'm not saying your pain isn't real. Better place. It's a better place. It's a better life. God has gone to create a new earth. No more death. No more sorrow. No more crying. And here John. John did not want to go on to give the list. But hear what he says. There shall be no more pain. In whatever form it comes. No more financial pain. No more COVID pain. No more pain. For the former things are passed away. I want to today encourage myself as I encourage you to know that the God who created in the first instance a perfect world for human beings to live in will recreate this one and give it back to us again. And if you ask me why I do what I do, if you ask me why I gave my life to the Lord as a teenage boy, and I'm 60 years old plus and still believe and walk with him, is because I know that there's a better day. Because I know that there's a tomorrow. Because I know that my loved ones who sleep in Jesus, I will see them once more. My brother who sleeps, my sister who sleeps in Jesus, my own mother who sleeps in Jesus, will come again to life one day. And so, sister, the families who mourn today, I give you Jesus. I give you his promises. And I give you the hope of all hopes. The coming of the Lord and a new heaven and a new earth where we shall live in peace forevermore, nevermore to part. May God bless you and bless us.
Thank you so much, Pastor Joseph. We are grateful for the words of comfort, words of cheer. I want to say to those who are signatories to the register, could you meet me in the back? We need to send to sign the register at this time. And I think, Sister Patrice, you will give us special music again. So those who are supposing to sign the register, meet me in the back, please. Could you at this time?
I'm trying hard not to think you unkind, but Heavenly Father, if you know my heart, surely you could read my mind. Good people underneath the sea of grief, some get up and walk away, some will find ultimate relief. Oh, I'm free, eventually. At the ultimate healing, we will be home free. Home free. Oh, I've got a feeling. At the ultimate healing, we will be home free. Out in the corridors, we pray for life. A mother for her baby, a husband for his wife. Oh, sometimes the good die young, it's sad but true. And while we pray for one more heartbeat, the real comfort is with you. You know, pain has little mercy. And suffering's no respecter of age, of race, or position. I know every prayer gets answered, but the hardest one to pray is slow to come. Oh Lord, not mine, but your will be done. Oh, let it be.
Eventually, at the ultimate healing, we will be whole.
We will be whole.
Home free. Oh, I've got a feeling.
I've got a feeling. We'll
be whole.
We'll be whole. At the ultimate healing, we're gonna be home free. Home free, oh, it's more than a feeling. At the ultimate healing, we're gonna be home free. Home free. We're gonna be home. Ultimate healing.
We're
gonna be
whole.
humanity. It's hard to believe he still loves me, knowing how wrong I have been. When all I can say is I'm sorry, when all I can feel is my sin. He understands when all I can do is cry. He feels a hurt that no one can see down inside. And when the words get in, for he understands my tears. You may not believe that for all you can see is my smile. Oh, he hears the heart that's unspoken, and he gives me strength through each trial. Understands when all I can do is cry. He feels the hurt that no one can see down inside. And when the words get in, he understands my tears. Oh, when the words get in the way, I know he still hears. For he understands when no
We want to thank Sister Patrice for this wonderful song. And now we invite you to stand as we will have the recessional time. Could we stand, everybody? Let us pray. And now to you, great one, who watch all things that transpires on this planet. We thank you for having been with us. But God, we leave this place to the burial site when we shall lay Sister Rosabella. We ask for your blessings upon the relatives, the mother, the grandmother, great-grandmother, and great-great-grandmother. Be with them, we pray, Lord. allow for them to be mindful of the fact this life has the pain, the suffering that comes with it. But the assurance, as was said rightly by earth. So as we wait in eager expectancy, one of these days, Lord, roll back the cloud like a scroll and ride forth as King of Kings and Lord of Lords and all of God's children, black and white, rich and poor, one day will be at their Father's house. We thank you today. We pray, Lord, to continue to be with the family. The days ahead would be painful, but lighten their pain. Allow for the grief to be less day by day. And thank you once again for being with us in Jesus' name. Amen. We keep standing as we do the recessional. I just want to say to all of you, whatever you came in here with, please make sure that you take it along with you. We go now to the cemetery in Fonsor where we would lay the remains of little Bella.
I shall see the King. I shall see the King where the angels sing. I shall see the King someday in the better land on the golden strand, and with him shall ever stay in his glory. I shall see the King and forever endless praises sing. 'Twas on Calvary Jesus died for me. I shall see the King someday.
There's one area we want to enact before we leave, and that is you who came to give support to the family. They want to express in a very definite way their appreciation and thanks for you having been with them, standing with them in their moment of prayer. So please have your seat as we do the vote of thanks at this time. Give it your mic.
Wait, sorry.
I deem it a great pleasure and privilege to propose a vote of thanks on this saddened day. Let me start by giving thanks to the Almighty God for allowing us to come together in this time of grief. The family of the late Ziva Bella Joseph would like to express our heartfelt gratitude to those who showed up to celebrate the life of our loving daughter, granddaughter, niece, cousin, friend. We would also like to thank those who reached out through calls, messages, and also those who made contributions towards funeral arrangements. Last but not least, thank you to Pastor Miller for making this service as memorable as it can be. We are deeply appreciative for all the prayers. Thank you, everyone, for your support. May Ziva Bella Joseph's soul rest in peace. Thank you.
We have the call to come to the floor.
In the land of song, in the glory throne, where there never comes a night, with my Lord once slain, I shall never reign in the glory land of light. In his glory, I shall see the King. I
let's praise and sing. 'Twas on Calvary Jesus died for me. I shall see the King someday. I shall see the King all my tributes bring, and shall look upon his face. Then my song shall be how he ransomed me and has kept me by his grace. In his glory I shall see the King, and forever endless praises sing. 'Twas on Calvary